Hello, we're now going to look at what 2D arrays are and how we declare them and how we start to index them. So there are lots of topics in computer science where, as a teacher, I really want students to think hard about it and really, really concentrate. This is one of the topics where actually overthinking it can cause quite a lot of problems. If we just think of 2D arrays as being arrays within arrays, that really summarizes what a 2D array is. And the more we think about that and try and define it more tightly, actually the more it can get confusing, I think. So we want to kind of think a medium amount about this topic. To kind of reword that a little bit, a 2D array, short for two-dimensional, has elements that are also arrays. The arrays we've looked at so far are one-dimensional arrays because each element was an integer or a string. But here, the elements are also arrays. So how does this potentially look? Well, quite a long line here. I've had to shrink it down a little bit. I'm declaring an array. So I've got the array keyword. My identifier here is cities. It's the name of my array. And it looks like an array. I've got square brackets, I've got commas, and I've got strings. But the key difference is I've now got items or elements which are also arrays. Geneva and Zurich consist one array. We can see it's got square brackets. Rome and Turin consist of another array. And Paris and Lyon also is an array. And these are elements within our wider array. You can see I've got commas separating these because these are elements within this wider array. So cities is a 2D array. Geneva, Zurich is a 1D array. Rome, Turin, 1D array. Paris, Lyon, 1D array. They are inside a 2D array. And I'm tempted to say that's it. You know, that is kind of the concept of a 2D array. We've got a bit more to talk about, but that's basically the concept. So if I was to do something like print cities.length, this would give us three, because really cities has got three elements. Dot length gives us how many elements an array has. It has got three. They just happen to be arrays. And so if I was to print cities index zero, well, what is cities index zero? Well, cities has got three items. Index zero points towards our first item, which happens to be Geneva and Zurich. That happens to be an array. So this would print out the array. Whether we would lose our quotation marks or not depends on the language, but it doesn't matter. We get given an array because that's what the element is. However, the slightly confusing bit is I can also add a second index number, because if I wanted to just get Geneva, I would need to index it again. And this is how it's done in OCR-ERL. In Python, we would have two separate square brackets. In OCR-ERL, we have a comma between our two index numbers. So the first index number refers to which element we're looking at. And the second index number is kind of going inside that array and then looking at the index within that array. So Geneva is in our first array and is the first item in that array. That's why when I have 0, 0 as my indices, I get Geneva. Whereas if I had cities index 1, 0, we're looking at index 1, which is our second array in cities. So the 1 refers to this array. This is 0, this is 1, this is 2. But then the 0 refers to Rome, which is index 0 within this array. Turin is index 1, which is why I get Rome outputted when I run that line of code. So don't overthink it. The first index number refers to which array we're looking at within our 2D array. And the second index number refers to which item within that array we're looking at. And you know, the comma notation is confusing, especially if you've used Python. So it's important that you, if you know Python, you recognize that's how OCR will show it. It's the same thing as in Python, just in Python, we've got separate square brackets for each one. Now, like in 1D arrays, I'm able to reassign elements. So arrays are fixed length, but I can definitely change elements if I want to. So that includes the array itself, the array which is part of it, or it includes an item within one of the arrays. So if I wanted to change Lyon to be Nice, well, Lyon has got the index 2, 1, because the 2 refers to the outer array, and then index 1 refers to Lyon's position. So I can reassign Lyon to be Nice. And so if I printed cities index 2, this would print the whole array, which is now Paris and Nice. Now, I just want to show you this so we don't get thrown if we were to see it. We occasionally, because like the line I just showed you is quite long, we occasionally write 2D arrays across multiple lines just because, like I say, they get a bit long. Here is one way of doing it where after each array within the 2D array, I'm doing a comma and then move on to a new line. So each of my sub arrays is on a separate line. That's one way of doing it. Just the key thing not to forget if you're writing this yourself is don't forget you've got an opening square bracket and an ending square bracket, and they belong to the 2D array itself, not each individual array. That's why I've got a double square bracket at the start, double at the end, because the opening and closing one refer to cities, not each individual array within it. So we can have multiple lines. We also have a slightly annoying notation, which you might also see. So I don't need to get thrown if you see this as well. Here is how we might reference it if I'm declaring it formally. Declaration is where we are creating something like an array and giving it some properties, such as its length. So the code on the right is equivalent to the code on the left. The first line is us declaring the array called cities, which has three arrays within it, each of length 2. Remember, arrays are fixed length, including 2D arrays, so they always have the length they are declared with. You can't increase the length after that point. And then in the following lines, I'm indexing it manually and setting each of our elements one by one, which is also fine, just a bit longer to do. Now, why do we do this? Why do we go through the trouble of creating 2D arrays? And you can even have, not to scare you, you can even have 3D arrays or even higher dimensions than that, but we're not at GCSE. So why do we do this? Well, it can help organize separate but related groups of data. It's all about groups in data structures. So the equivalent to what I just showed you, we could have three separate 1D arrays, which have got their own identifiers. A bit like the reasoning for why we have 1D arrays, well, eventually I'm going to run out of identifiers, and it's quite repetitive having the same sort of names as we go through. I mean, in this particular case, I might call this Swiss cities or Italian cities or French cities, give it a more sensible name. However, if I'm storing every country on Earth, that is a huge amount of code and probably better to group it. And grouping it means I can do processing on it a lot more easily. I can iterate through one data structure as opposed to 200 separate arrays, which is too much work to do. We'll look at how you can do some of the processing in the next video because it's its own thing to learn. But another fact for you to understand now is we often also use 2D arrays to emulate database tables. Emulation is where we are sort of pretending something it's not. A 2D array isn't a database, but we can represent databases often using 2D arrays. So a database is just a super duper organized store of data, usually multiple tables, which are really quite big. They've got columns, which are formerly called fields in databases, and records, which are formerly called, well, they're what rows are. Here I'm storing four people's scores, maybe from a video game. These are numbers. Now, databases are really, really good for searching data. I can search for data really quite easily using SQL, which we'll look at in a separate video, but they're not very good for processing. So if I wanted to find the average score for everybody in this database, or I wanted to find the average score for each person in the database, something like that is not really possible to do unless I import it into a programming language. And I might import it into a 2D array. How to do that is not important at GCSE, but I could import this into a 2D array to take the values and store it. And hopefully you can see where this is coming from. Well, each row, each record is being stored as its own array within my wider 2D array. So my first row is my first element, second row, second element, and so on and so on. This enables me to iterate through it and do processing using indexing, which is a lot easier than leaving it in the database format. We'll look at how we do that in the next video. However, one final thing just to point out before I go is the person column here isn't in my 2D array, so I didn't import it into my 2D array. And that's potentially because arrays can only have elements of one data type. You can see I've got integers in all of this, so putting a string inside this array may not be allowed in the programming language I'm using. You could perhaps get around this by making all of the elements strings, so putting all of these numbers in as strings and then casting them later into integers, but you may also just not import certain columns if they don't match the data type you want to use.